Tonight's Majlis is to commemorate the alternative debt, which has been mentioned by some of the scholars for the Shahadat of Bibi Fatima al-Zahra, salawatullah alayha. Although from the point of discussion and research, our preference is for the date which is in the early days of the following month, Jamadi al-Thaniya. But nonetheless, you know, there is absolutely no issue in remembering Ahlul Bayt, especially Bibi Fatima al-Zahra, salawatullah alayha. Especially keeping in mind the controversies which have started since the 90s, which didn't exist before as far as her shahadat and suffering is concerned. For tonight, I would like to actually talk about the importance of the house of Fatima, the term Bayt Fatima, followed by the question whether that Bayt of Fatima was attacked or not. I'll keep it brief, but I would like this to be kind of a final and decisive, you know, discussion about it. Inshallah, we'll continue that tomorrow night also. And so inshallah, you will be with me at least for this 40 minutes. Salawat, Pranik Parah. The term Bayt Fatima, the house of Fatima. Normally in our Eastern culture, you relate the house to the men of the house. But we see interestingly when it comes to the incidents after the wafat of Rasulullah, Shia and Sunni both, when they talk about this incident, what happened, they always use the term Bayt Fatima. They don't say Bayt Ali. And I thought maybe it would be, you know, important to just to understand that concept, that there must be a basis for it. When we talk about the Bayt, the house of Ali and Fatima, you know, it's not just an ordinary house. You see, in the world, everything is not considered to be on the same level. Even when you talk about the Anbiya and Mursaleen, you already had divided them into hierarchy. Those who are prophets, Anbiya, they are at a lower level compared to those who are Mursaleen. Mursaleen means those who are messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A Rasul is also a Nabi, but a Nabi is not a Rasul. And even in that numbering, we have 124,000 prophets, 313 of them are Mursaleen. And out of those, there is also a hierarchy among them. You have five of them whom we call Ulul Azm prophets. And so we see that even when it comes to Anbiya, you look at the story of the Malaika, even a place like Masjid. The neighborhood masjid is not on the same status as Jame Masjid, a masjid which is where people gather from many neighborhoods together for Jummah prayers. Around the world, when you look at masajid, you know, Masjid al-Nabi is greater than other masajid. Masjid al-Haram is even higher than that in rank. And so even when it comes to the places of worship, there is kind of a difference. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, when he talks about even the families of Anbiya and Mursaleen, he uses a term in Surah Al-Imran. Allah uses the term istafa. Istafa means to choose, to select. And that's how you have the title of the Prophet as Al-Mustafa, who has been chosen or selected. Inna Allah astafa, Allah says, you know, when he looks at the humanity, he is making a statement here that verily Allah chosen Adam as the first human being. Wa Nuhan, And then, you know, because of the flood, majority of the human beings perished. So Nuh as a second Adam is mentioned there. After that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't go to the names individually. He says, Wa'ala Ibrahim. And he chose the descendants of Ibrahim. He adds the word Wa'ala Imran, who were already covered by Ala Ibrahim, just to make us realize that not every descendant of Ibrahim is worthy of being selection of the Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There is a standard that Allah uses, and some of them are selected, some are not, from both lines of Ishaq as well as the line of Ismail. When you look at the line of Ismail, Ali Ibrahim applies to Muhammad and Ali Muhammad alayhim salatu wasalam. So Ali Muhammad are chosen ones. When you talk about the Panjatan, Ayat Athir is there to talk about their purity and infallibility. But it's not only the persons who are known as Ahle Kisa or Panjatan, as we call them in Urdu of Farsi, that they are the ones who are on that level of perfection. Even the places and things associated to them acquires a special blessing from Allah subhanahu. Even that house in which Ali and Fatima lived becomes a selected place, becomes a sacred place. And you might say, well, where he is getting all this from? Let me go to Surah Nur, Surah number 24 of the Quran, Ayat 36 to 38, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, talking about the impact of the divine light and nur of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, how it goes to different levels of the universe and how it impacts. Then he says, "Fi buyutin adhina Allahu an turfa' wa yuskar fiha ismuhu yusabbihu lahu fiha bil-ghudubi wal-asal." He says, in the houses. Now he's talking about special houses. It says, in the houses that Allah has permitted to be raised or elevated. You know, people have a problem with building shrines of the Anbiya or the Imam. This is the ayat. It's not talking about, you know, turfa in a sense, zikr, because it comes. Wa yuthkar, and therein his name is chanted. And he is glorified in them during the mornings and the mid-afternoons. Rijalun, he says, these are the houses in which you will find men whom neither tajaratan wala bay'an dhikrillah wa iqam as-salat wa ita'i zakat. You know, there are men in there, there are people in there whom neither business nor sale diverts from remembering Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from performing the prayers and giving the charity. Then he goes on. This is because they fear the day of judgment, you know, where everything will be, you know, clear in front of us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses the words in this ayat where he says, even the hearts and the minds of people will be transformed. Not in a physical sense, but the reality will be there. Nobody will be able to deny what is the truth. And then he talks about the reward. Now, what are these houses that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is talking about? Fi buyutin adhina Allah an turfa' wa yuthkar fiha ismu. That the houses that Allah has allowed to be raised or elevated, and in which the name of Allah is chanted or recited. This is a question which was actually asked by one of the companions when the Prophet recited this ayah for the first time to them. And we should be thankful to those companions who asked these questions. More interestingly, the follow-up question which will come up. This is a narration not from a Shia tafsir. This is from Jalaluddin Suyuti. This is a hadith based tafsir of the Sunnis. There, Jalaluddin Suyuti quotes in his Ad-Durrul Manthur two individuals, Anas bin Malik and Buraida, that they, when the Prophet recited these three ayat about the buyut, about the houses, you know, a person stood up and he asked the Prophet, and he says, what are these houses that they have been mentioned in this ayat of Quran? And this is where the Prophet says, buyutul anbiya. This refers not to just ordinary house or a masjid. This refers to the houses of the prophets. When I say the follow-up question, then a very prominent Sahabi stood up. Suyuti names him. He says, then Abu Bakr stood up. As a follow-up question, I don't know why he asked this question. Probably he knew something that we don't know. Because he asked Rasulullah, Ya Rasulullah, هذا البيت منها لبيت علي وفاطمة. These houses that you are mentioning, which have been mentioned in this ayat of Quran, and you are saying this is referring to the buyut al-anbiya, is this house of Ali and Fatima included in that group or not? For him even to raise that question is very interesting. At least for that moment we'll say thank you. At least you raised this question and we got the answer from Rasulullah. Then Rasulullah responds by saying, Na'am. Yes, the house of Ali and Fatima is included in that list. Not only that, من أفاضلها. It is among the best of those houses. Salawat Panam Iqbara. So the house of Fatima is not just a house. It is a house which is included in this ayat where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says He has allowed those houses to be elevated, raised. And in these houses, Allah's name is chanted and recited. And this is where we are to realize that, you know, when we see this term, Bayt Fatima, it has a meaning behind it. There is a sacredness and holiness attached to that place, which was the residence of Ali and Fatima, salawatullah alayhum. But let me come to the main question. What happened to Bayt Fatima? What happened to House of Fatima after Rasulullah? You know, Rasulullah identified that as one of the best and elevated houses in the eyes of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The expectation was that Muslims in general will respect not only the people of the house, but the house itself. But the irony is that the same people who actually asked this question of Rasulullah, whether the house of Ali and Fatima is included in this list or not, they were the first one actually who oppressed the people of the house. And they burned down its door. And in that process, they basically hurt the daughter of the Prophet. And this is where I come to this question, because as soon as we talk about this, with this era of internet and social media, fast communication, every year during this time, these issues come up. Is this really happening? Was this true? Is there evidence for this? People find it difficult to accept that the close companions of the Prophet would do such a thing to his family, especially to his beloved daughter. Many times we hear, even from the scholars from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, even the Sufis who actually respect the Ahlul Bayt, When it comes to this incident, they said, no, we don't believe in it. They find it difficult. And immediately we hear the words that this story has been fabricated by the Shias to tarnish the image of some of the companions of the Prophet. And their target in this whole accusation is Sulaym bin Qais, one of the earlier narrators of Hadith and a disciple of Amir al-Mu'mineen Ali bin Abi Talib alayhi salatu wasalam. Sulaym bin Qais was a trusted and close companion of Ali. There is no doubt about his personality, his authenticity, you know, his character. Of course, the book that he wrote and what is known as Kitab al-Sulaym or Kitab al-Saqifa, that was its actual title. There is a discussion among our ulama, senior ulama, whether the existing version of the book, is it the actual work of Sulaym, or there has been some editing, manipulation, deletions, and changes. So there are two different things. Even though those ulama who would not accept the present existing, you know, version of Kitab al-Sulaym are not doubting the authenticity of this person known as Sulaym bin Qais, including people like Ayatollah Khoi in his latest book. One of his last legacy was the book on Ilm al-Rijal, you know, on the biography and scrutiny of the narrators of Hadith. He's very clear about it, that whether you accept the present version as the authentic version of what Sulaym bin Qais wrote is something you can debate on it, question it, but as far as the personality and character of Sulaym bin Qais is concerned, is beyond any, you know, doubt that he is a siqa and a reliable companion of the Prophet. But I'm not even going to his book. I'm not even talking about the book of Sulaym. What I would like to do tonight is go to one of the earliest source of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah themselves. And I'll bring to you a point where there can be then no doubt that the zulm took place, injustice happened against Fatima and her house. Salawat pranay ikbar. You see, whenever you have a case between an oppressor and the oppressed, of course the oppressed will protest, accuse the other. But the most important thing is to see whether the oppressor and the unjust and the zalim is confessing to that or not. What I would like to present to you, probably I may have talked about it before, but I've not been addressing Fatimiyya Majalis for many years. So I thought I'll present this in a short form. There is a very famous Sunni scholar, a faqih and a mujtahid in his own right, by the name of Abu Ubaid al-Qasim bin Salam. He was an expert in financial matters. He wrote a book called Kitab al-Amwal. First time I read it many years ago when I was writing my book on Khums, just wanted to see what is the Sunni perspective about the history of Khums after Rasulullah. And his book is one of the comprehensive books on financial matter of those days, written from the Sunni point of view. He died in the year 224 of Hijrah. Why am I giving you this age or the day, year of his death? It is very important. Timeline is very important. Kitab al-Amwal, the book of Abu Ubaid, was written before Sahih Bukhari. Sahih Bukhari is considered to be the first comprehensive compilation of hadith among Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Abu Ubaid came before Bukhari. His book is there, which came before that. Just to give you the timeline from the Shi'i perspective, Abu Ubaid was contemporary of our 10th Imam. So now you have this 10th Imam's time, Abu Ubaid is there, Bukhari comes just after him. He is very much highly respected by the Sunni scholars. They describe him as al-Imam, the leader, al-Hafidh, somebody with a very good memory, husnul riwayah, good in narrating a hadith, sahihun naql, authentic in quoting a hadith. These are the attributes that they have for him. He was a mushtahid and a faqih, a jurist in his own right. Abu Ubaid there talks about an incident narrated by Abdurrahman bin Auf. Abdurrahman bin Auf is a prominent, companion among the school of the Sahaba. And Abdurrahman bin Auf actually described his visit to Abu Bakr when the Khalifa was on his deathbed. So this is the last days of Abu Bakr. Abdurrahman bin Auf, as a friend, goes to visit him, Ayadat. And he is the one who quotes something which is very important. He says, Abu Bakr told me that I don't have any regrets for what I've done, except three things. I had wished, I had asked about them from Rasulullah. Put it on the side, it's not relevant to our theme. Then he says, and there are three things. أَمَّآنِي لَا آسِي عَلَى شَيْءٍ إِلَّا السَّلَاسَ فَعَلْتُهُمْ. He says, but I really regret, I do not regret on anything, except three things that I have done. وَدُدْتُ أَنِّي لَمْ أَفْعَلُهُمْ. I wish I had not done them. Abu Ubaid, such a high-ranking scholar, considered to be trustworthy, sahihun naql, very authentic in, quoting the statements, mentions two things that Abu Bakr regrets doing. But when it comes to the third one, he says, وَوَدُدْتُ أَنِّي لَمْ أَكُنْ فَعَلْتُ. I wish I had not done. After that, Abu Ubaid changes the words, kawa wa kawa. I wish I had not done so and so. Or sometimes you just put three dots in the statement where you don't want to quote. So these are the three dots, kawa wa kawa. And then actually he says, la uridu athkuruha. Abu Ubaid says, I don't feel comfortable to mention that. Three things the Khalifa is saying, I wish I had not done. Two things Abu Ubaid is mentioning clearly. Third one, he says, kawa wa kawa. He says, I wish I had not done so and so. Why? Because he says, I don't feel comfortable mentioning it. A prominent scholar coming before Bukhari, known as Sahihun Naql, he's concealing one of the three regrets of Abu Bakr. I would like to make a point here. Many people, when they will hear, what is this kawa wa kawa? They will say, oh, this is fabrication, this is za'if narration, not valid. Go and ask Abu Ubaid. If this was a fabrication and a lie, he could have written it down and give his comment that I don't believe this narration to be true. But he doesn't do it. He conceals this. He is hiding that. It means in views of this scholar, whatever he is hiding and concealing was the truth. But he wasn't comfortable because of his own affiliation to the group or the, his aqeedah. And you know, so this narration cannot be, and this is what they have done. Many Sunni scholars, when they read the whole story, they say, oh, this is all fabrication. Well, this is not a Shia guy. Abu Ubaid was your own scholar, coming before Imam Bukhari. But remember, the truth cannot be hidden. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. Abu Ubaid hid the truth. But there are other Sunni scholars who have come and given the entire quotation and the words of Abdurrahman bin Auf in its entirety. Just a generation after Abu Ubaid, you come to Tabari. Those who read Muslim history, Islamic history, you must be familiar with the name of Tabari. A very famous Sunni scholar, known for his history, but he was not only a historian, he was a faqih and a mujtahid in his own right. He didn't follow any of the four madhahib. He followed his own fatwas. And he also has a very prominent tafsir. So he was a historian, a jurist, and a commentator of the Quran. Very, very learned person. He comes a generation after Abu Ubaid. He lived in 224 to 310th year of the Hijrah. And when you look at Abu Ubaid, he died in 224. So he's just next and a generation after Abu Ubaid. Tabari in his book, through his own sources and channel and sanad, quotes the conversation of Abdurrahman bin Auf about the regret of the first Khalifa. And the words that Abu Ubaid had as kaza wa kaza, look at the narration from Tabari. Tabari says that the Khalifa said, wa amma thalatha wadadtu anni taraktuhunna fawadadtu. The three things that I regret, that I would have not done it. فَوَدَدْتُ أَنِّي I wish لَمْ أَكْشِفْ بَيْتَ فَاطِمَا عَنْ شَيْءٍ. He's saying, I wish I had not, akshif means opened up or exposed, forcefully open something. I wish I had not opened up the house of Fatima for any purpose. He says, وَإِنْ كَانُوا قَدْ عَلَّقُوهُ عَلَى الْحَرْبِ. Even if they had closed that door for the purpose of fighting. Means even if they were conspiring against me, I wish I would have not exposed the house of Fatima. Opened the door of the house of Fatima. And this is where we see, you know, this is a confession from the first Khalifa himself. So don't tell me this is a story fabricated by the Shias or by Sulaim bin Qais. When you have this simple confession from the perpetrator, this is sufficient to establish the fact that the house of Bibi Fatima was attacked. That is the basis of the event. And this is where, you know, people say, but well, all the stories we hear about it, the details about here. My response is very simple. If those who are responsible, they confess to this happening of this event, the details you don't ask from those who had done it. Go and ask the mazloom. If the zalim comes and says, yes, I have done it, but how did I do it? To what extent did I do it? We don't need to hear it from the zalim. We can hear that from the mazloom. And so if you don't have the details from the other party, go to those who were actually the victims and ask them. You know, this is something which cannot be forgotten. If you look at the family of Ahlul Bayt, the son of the eighth Imam, we're talking about seven generations between Fatima and our ninth Imam. There is a narration by a companion of the eighth Imam that one day I was in his presence, and the ninth Imam was just 4 years old, came in, sat down. You can visualize, you know, a small child with both hands on the ground looking up. And the father looks at the son and says, "Oh, my son, what are you thinking?" Because the child is looking up. And that four-year-old child, seventh generation of Fatima, says, "My father, I'm thinking what happened to my grandmother." And this is what I say. If the zalim has given his clear confession, you know, don't tell me now, prove what happened. How did it happen? What is the impact of on Fatima the Zahra? We don't need their narration. We don't need their, version. That's where we will go to our version. Our sources from the victims and the mazlumin. Inshallah, tomorrow night I'll present you one more document from Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah, which talks about, you know, this event. Yes, definitely it happened. There is no doubt about it. Khudawande Allah aap logon ko sab logon ko salamat rakhe. In zamane mein jo shak aur shubhat paida kiye jaate hain, isse ghabrane ki baat nahi hai. Bas apne malumat ko zara badhaye, sahib nazar se jaake poochiye. Amir al-Mu'mineen aur unke chahne walon mein taqriban 10 ya 12 historians mein difference hai numbers ke bare mein. वो सब जमा हो गए थे जनाबे फातिमा के घर. उन्वान यही है, बैत फातिमा. आपने खलीफे अव्वल के भी उन्वान में भी देखा, बैत फातिमा है, बैत अली नहीं कहा है. ये लोग जमा हो गए थे एहतजाज के तौर पे. वो इस बात को मानने के लिए तैयार नहीं थे जहां पब्लिक को फोर्सफुली कहा जा रहा था कि जाके वो खलीफे अव्वल की बैत करें. जब उमर इब्न खत्ताब को मालूम हुआ कि अली के चाहने वाले उनके घर जमा हुए हैं, वो बार बार खलीफा के पास जाए, कहें कि भाई आपको ये बर्दाश्त नहीं करना चाहिए. यू शुडंट लेट इट गो. और उस वक्त खलीफा के मर्जी के मुताबिक जो होने वाले सेकंड खलीफा थे, ये अपने साथियों के साथ, एक ग्रुप के साथ, जनाबे सैयदा के दरवाजे के पास आते हैं. बहुत सी बातें हैं लेकिन न मौका है, किसी और वक्त पे. कि जब दरवाजे पे आया है और उसने ये कहा है कि जो लोग जमा हैं उनको निकाला जाए, तो दरवाजे के पीछे जवाब देने वाली बिनत रसूल थी. यह भी सवाल उठता है कि अली क्यों नहीं गए थे दरवाजे पर, बीवी क्यों गई थी. वो एक अलग बहस है इंशाल्लाह किसी और वक्त. इसमें अली की मजलूमियत है. ये लोग अली को तो रिकॉग्नाइज नहीं कर रहे थे. घर को भी बेत फातिमा कहा है. कम से कम फातिमा बिनत रसूल हैं, उस रिश्ते को का ख्याल करते हुए मुमकिन है शायद उनकी बात को सुन लें, इसलिए फातिमा जाती है. یہ نہیں ہے کہ نعوذ باللہ جو ہے علی کو کیا ہو گیا تھا, وہ خود بیٹھے رہے بیوی کو بھیج دیا. نعوذ باللہ, اس طرح سے لوگ جو ہیں بے غیرتی کا سوال کرتے ہیں جو خود بے غیرت ہے. جناب سیدہ دروازے کے پیچھے ہیں, جب کہا گیا کہ اگر ان مردوں کو نہ نکالا جائے تو ان کو اس گھر کے ساتھ جلا دیں گے. ہمارے مسلمان بہت سے کہتے ہیں صرف دھمکی دی تھی, لیکن آپ نے خلیفہ اول کا عنوان سن لیا ہے کہ دروازے کو کھولا تھا, گھر کو کھولا تھا فورسفلی. جناب سیدہ اس وقت یہی کہتی ہیں لیکن یہ میرا گھر ہے, تم ابھی بھی میرے بابا کا کلمہ پڑھتے ہو, ہم تمہارے رسول کی بیٹی ہیں. جواب ملا کہ وی ڈونٹ کیئر. بچوں کی معصومیت کو ذہن میں رکھتے ہوئے فاطمہ کہتی ہیں اس گھر میں حسن اور حسین بھی ہیں. پھر بھی یہ جواب ملا کہ ہمیں پرواہ نہیں ہے. یہاں تک کہ پھر لکڑیاں لائی جاتی ہیں, دروازے کو جلایا جاتا ہے, اور اس کے بعد وہ ظلم ہوا. مومنین, جب دھکا دیا گیا ہے اس دروازے پہ, دروازہ کھلا نہیں ہے بلکہ وہ جو ہنجز ہوتی ہے نا اس سے الگ ہو جاتا ہے. سیدہ دروازے اور دیوار کے درمیان آ جاتی ہیں. علامہ یامینی رحمت اللہ علیہ کا ایک بیان ہے ایک مجلس میں, کہتے ہیں یہ بڑا آسان ہے یہ کہہ دینا کہ فاطمہ دروازے اور دیوار کے درمیان آئی تھی. کہتی ہے تمہیں اندازہ نہیں ہے کہ جب یہ دروازہ ٹوٹا ہے اس میں ایک میخ لگی ہوئی تھی جو پیوست میں آ کے. سیدہ دیکھتی ہے کہ ہمیں تو اذیت ہوئی ہے لیکن وہ بچہ جو بطن میں تھا وہ بھی شہید ہو چکا. ایسے وقت پہ عورت کس کو آواز دیتی ہے؟ ایک عورت کو ہی پکارتی ہے, فوراً آواز دیتی ہے یا فضا الیہ الیہ. فضا آ کے مجھے سنبھالو. عزداران حسین اس وقت جو ہے یہ لوگ آ جاتے ہیں گھر کے اندر. ہم اس واقعے کو بیان نہیں کریں گے کہ امیر المومنین کا انیشیل ریئیکشن کیا تھا کسی اور وقت کے لیے, لیکن آخر میں سب کو گرفتار کیا جاتا ہے. امیر المومنین کے گردن میں بھی رسن باندھی جاتی ہے, کھینچ کے لایا جاتا ہے دربار خلافت میں اس حکم کے ساتھ کہ تم بیعت کرو. علی نے کہا اگر ہم بیعت نہ کریں گے تم کیا کرو گے؟ یہ عمر کا مکالمہ ہے امیر المومنین کے ساتھ. دینوی اپنی کتاب الامام و سیاسہ میں لکھا ہے, علی نے کہا کہ اگر ہم بیعت نہیں کریں گے تو تم کیا کرو گے؟ الفاظ ہے نو غریب انق, کہ آپ کی گردن کو ہم اڑا دیں گے. اس وقت علی نے ایک جملہ کہا ہے کہ اگر تم مجھے قتل کرو گے تو تم خدا کے بندے اور رسول کے بھائی کو قتل کرو گے. اس وقت وہ کہتا ہے کہ ہاں آپ خدا کے بندے ضرور ہیں لیکن رسول کے بھائی نہیں ہیں. ये जो लोग चाहते थे कि अली दरवाजे के पीछे आते, ये वो लोग हैं कि अली को रसूल का भाई मानने के लिए भी तैयार नहीं है। किस उनवान पे जाके बात करते उनसे, इसलिए सैयदा गई थी। इतनी देर में जनाब सैयदा को जब इफाका हुआ है, बीबी अपनी तमाम तकलीफों को भूल जाती है। पहला सवाल फिजा से था कि आई नहाली, अली कहां पे है। जब कहा गया कि अली को लेके गए हैं, फिजा के सहारे जनाब सैयदा अजीतों के बावजूद जाती हैं। करीब पहुंचने के बाद आवाज देती हैं कि अगर तुमने मेरे अबुल हसन को नहीं छोड़ा, हम अपने बाल को खोल के तुम्हारे खिलाफ बद्दुआ करेंगे। हमारी रवायात के मुताबिक सलमान अली को देख रहे थे। सलमान को अली ने इशारे से बुलाया, इमामत की नजर से अली देख रहे थे कि अभी सैयदा ने बद्दुआ नहीं की है, लेकिन मस्जिद नबी के दीवार हिलने शुरू हो चुके थे। फौरन कहते हैं, सलमान जाके फातिमा से कहो कि उम्मत के खिलाफ बद्दुआ न करे। उस हालत में भी अली उम्मत की बका चाहते थे। और इस वक्त खलीफे अव्वल ने फिर कहा है अबू बकर से, अली को छोड़ दो, जब तक फातिमा उनके साथ हैं अली को छोड़ दिया जाए। दौरान हुसैन एक जुमला हम कहना चाहेंगे, उस दिन जो है अली को कत्ल करने का सामान तैयार हो चुका था। आपके इमाम अव्वल के मुहाफिज अगर कोई है तो फातिमतु जहरा है। इन हालात में जब बीबी से सिर्फ इतना कहेंगे, बीबी आपके बद्दुआ की धमकी को सुन के फिर भी यहाँ जो है एक रद्द अमल हुआ है, लेकिन मुझे एक और खातून याद आती है कि जिन्होंने अपने जवान अली जैनुल आबिदीन को भी, आप ही की बेटी थी जो सामने आ जाती है दरबारे कूफा में, इब्ने ज़ियाद से कहती है, इब्ने ज़ियाद अगर जैनुल आबिदीन को कत्ल करना है पहले तुझे मुझे कत्ल करना। अलालानतुल्लाहि अल-क़ौमि ज़ालिमीन سيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون خدا وندہ اس کو روایت قبول فرما، ہمارے گناہوں کو بخش دے، ہمارے توفیقات میں اضافہ فرما۔ خدا وندہ جہاں جہاں شیعان علی ہیں خدا وندہ ان کو اپنے حفظ امان میں رکھ، تکفیری افواج کی تمام صلاحیتوں کو اور ریزورسز کو نیست و نابود فرما، امام کے ظہور میں تعجل فرما۔ ربنا تقبل منا انک انت السمیع العلیم۔ ماتم حسین۔